Hello, Gururaj sir. How are you?
Good, good, good. Doing well, Professor Guha.
Yeah, we met long back. Now it is 10 years.
Yes.
Me and Professor Majumdar, when we were in Boston, we had a very good discussion at your office.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank
Yeah.
you for all the good
So,
work you people do in India. So
yeah. So.
it's early morning here. It's 6 o'clock.
Okay.
And because it's winter time, the sun actually doesn't come out until almost
Okay.
7:30, 8 o'clock. So
Oh my God. So
it's all lights right now. So
difficult for you.
what's that?
It's little difficult for you in this early
No.
morning and winter morning. Yeah, I
No,
know.
this is the least I can do for you people. So this is the first day?
Yes.
Okay. And typically, how many people are attending these sessions? 60, 70?
Yeah, 70. I can see that 69. Charles, what is
How many
the
students do you have? How many students do you have in test campus?
total? If you think all the MA programs and MPhil PhD, it is more than 1,000. More than 1,500, but for the first year student, it is around 500 to 600 students. And for our class, actually, we have a cap 30 seats per year for ME in social entrepreneurship. But generally, 20 to 25, they join. I mean, they stick to the program. Because they join 30, but after 1 or 2 months, they find it difficult to start their own and all this. So they're also drop out of few students.
So it's a social entrepreneurship is one of the tracks.
Yeah. Actually, I can tell you that social entrepreneurship program, it's our this year it is 14th year. Comparatively junior program in TISS, because if we think about social work and human resource management or hospital administration, those are very old programs
I see.
in TISS.
Do people have to major in it, or they can just take a course in social entrepreneurship?
No, it is major. It is 2 years master's, full-fledged master's program, which we launched in 2007.
But the other people get a flavor of it?
Yes, we have some courses called CBCS, choice-based courses, so that can be opted by other students also. So few courses we are open for other students.
You know, because most of the universities, you know, entrepreneurship was a new thing, maybe 20, 30 years ago. But
Yeah.
now it's very much a part of the whole practice.
Yes.
You know, everybody has to be entrepreneurial, otherwise it's very hard to survive.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I think in
That's true.
fact, one of the universities here, they changed over the whole thing, and they call their program as difference makers.
Okay.
And so it doesn't matter whether they do nursing, music, journalism, engineering, or anything, but they all go through this orientation to be a difference maker. And
Okay.
the curriculum is all designed so that it doesn't matter which discipline you're in,
Okay.
you find a way to make a difference.
Oh, that's great. Okay, I think I'm so sorry to excuse your wonderful talk, but I think we are back. Our technical team is back again. So I once again welcome you all and wish you a very good evening. Moving ahead with our expert sessions, which is Sustainability Impact through Innovation and Entrepreneurship in India. Today, we have among us the founder of Deshpande Foundation, Mr. Gururaj Deshpande, whose work and contribution in the field of social entrepreneurship is wondrous and has always inspired young aspiring entrepreneurs like us. Sir has joined us from Boston, USA today, and I'm thanking you so much for taking out time for us at such an early hour of the day. It's around 6 a.m. there, so thank you so much, sir.
Gururaj sir is the president and chairman of Patha Group LLC, and Deshpande sir is also the founder of Cascade Communication and Psychomode Networks, and has chaired and funded several other companies. Sir is a life member of the MIT Corporation. The Deshpande Foundation support social entrepreneurship and provided the founding grant of NSF Innovation Corps and Deshpande Center at MIT. Sir holds a BTech from Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, an ME from the University of New Brunswick, Canada, and PhD from Queen's University, Canada. Deshpande sir co-chaired the National Council to support President Obama's innovation and entrepreneurship strategy from 2010 to 2015. A little about the foundation. Deshpande Foundation is an empowering ecosystem encouraging an entrepreneurial culture to problem solving in the community. It is a living laboratory for catalysts to test ideas, make problem solving in the community. Make change and eventually develop truly scalable solution that will address the pressing social challenges of the 1.1 billion living in rural and small metros of India. Well, unfortunately, due to some emergency, Professor Satyajit Mazumdar, who was previously going to be moderating the session, will not be able to do it. But to dive deep into the conversation with Mr. Deshpande, we have Professor Samapti Guha as our moderator for the session. I thank Samapti ma'am for happily accepting our invitation at such a short notice. Thank you, ma'am. A little about Samapti ma'am. Dr. Samapti Guha is working as a professor and chairperson at the Center of Social Entrepreneurship, School of Management and Labor Studies at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. She is a development economist and has done her PhD in economics from Jadavpur University in 2014. After her PhD, she worked as a researcher in the area of microfinance and development economics in reputed institutions such as Indian Institute of Dalit Studies, New Delhi, and Institute of Rural Management, Anand, Gujarat. In 2006, she was selected as Sir Ratan Tata Fellowship at the London School of Economics and Political Science, UK, for her postdoctoral studies. Her area of research are microfinance, women micro entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship, child labor issues, financial literacy, financial capability, and financial inclusion. She is teaching courses like microfinance, microeconomics, economic orientation for strategic management, microeconomics, and development economics. She has also published many articles in national and international journals and in books. So without taking much time, I would like to hand over the session to Mr. Gururaj Deshpande and Professor Samapti Guha. Over to you.
Okay. Thank you, Mrinmoy, to invite Mr. Deshpande. And it's my great pleasure to moderate this session. Sir, with your due permission, I place some issues which are raised by my beloved students. And I think we will, have this session in a, more interactive mode. So their first issue they all would like to know that how do you perceive the social innovation in the area of entrepreneurship, especially in social entrepreneurship? If you can focus on, your perception as well as the efforts of social innovation, successful social innovation in this field. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Guha. And also I want to welcome all the TIS students. And, I think we can talk about a lot of issues, but I think it's more important that we talk about very specific things that you may be thinking about. So I would encourage all of you to make sure that you are active in the Q&A session and send your questions to Professor Guha, and I can also see them here. So Professor Guha, maybe it may be a good thing to tell about what entrepreneurship has done and why we can apply some similar principles to the social entrepreneurship. So what is entrepreneurship? Entrepreneurship is, you know, it wasn't a commonplace, you know, like 40 years ago or something, when I came to US and then started my companies, there were very few entrepreneurs. So, but now the what is known as entrepreneurship is everywhere. So what is entrepreneurship? Entrepreneurship is you look at the world and it is A, and you say, it doesn't have to be A, it can be B, it can be better. And I want to get there. And the path isn't very clear, but your passion to get to B is so convincing and your conviction is so strong that you'll find a way to get there. You'll find the solutions, you'll find the resources, you'll find the people, you'll do everything. So you don't have anything to start with, but you put it all together. But the way the regular entrepreneurship works is that you go from A to B and you find a solution. And typically the solution is for the people who have disposable income, who can afford to pay for the solution, right? And so they can pay for it. And a lot of people start and only some people succeed. And those who find a solution for which the cost is less than what people are willing to pay become successful, right? Because if people pay more than what it costs you, then you have a sustainable business. You can build a business. If you don't, you die. You know, that's the end of that company, but that's okay. You know, I think, and long, long time ago, 40, 50 years ago, if you fail, the consequences were very damaging. I mean, you were branded for life. But now, failing is considered, it's a part of the journey, right? It's a career path. You may succeed the first time, second time, third time, fourth time. But every time you put in the effort, you become that much more experienced. So you know that much more what to do. So entrepreneurship in the regular sense has become a career. And I'm sure in India, you're seeing it everywhere now. You know, a lot of talk about entrepreneurship. And if you just go to your story, you'll see thousands of stories of entrepreneurs who have made fantastic things. And they're leveraging technology, they're leveraging whatever, you know, anything that you think can be better than what it is today creates an entrepreneurship. Now, what is social entrepreneurship? Social entrepreneurship is the same thing. You know, you look at the world and you say, it can be better. But it becomes a lot harder because the people that you're trying to help may or may not be able to pay for that solution. And so one thing that you need in social entrepreneurship is compassion. Just like in the previous session, Urvashi was talking. Without that compassion, you have no beginning in social entrepreneurship. Because your bottom line in a regular entrepreneurship is you have top line, the revenue, and you have profits at the bottom line. And the bigger the profits, the more successful you are. In the social entrepreneurship, your bottom line is impact. You're looking for how many people you can impact. You may not financially benefit yourself, but you're creating a huge impact. And so it's a little bit of a harder journey and it's less reward. It's social entrepreneurship is where regular entrepreneurship was maybe 30, 40 years ago. So the whole ecosystem does not exist. The way to finance it does not exist. That we don't have a lot of role models for social entrepreneurship, even though there's quite a few who are coming along. And so social entrepreneurship is 10 times harder than regular entrepreneurship. But the good thing is if you do find solutions and find ways to scale them, it's amazing what you can do, you know, because in regular entrepreneurship, you're seeing companies like whether it's Google or Reliance or Facebook or Microsoft or any of these things, you can see how amazing their solutions scale and they impact everybody's life, right? So you can use similar techniques in social entrepreneurship to make them to have a big impact. Now, maybe Professor Guha, I can make one more comment and then we can talk about any specific things that students may want to ask also. So the question is, how do you finance social entrepreneurship, right? So there's only three sources of income. I said in regular entrepreneurship, a person has to be willing to pay, a customer has to be willing to pay more than what it costs you, right? That's what makes a business sustainable. In social entrepreneurship also, you do have to bring in more money every year than what it costs you. So where does the revenue come from? In social entrepreneurship, it comes from sometimes the beneficiary, because they can pay for some of it or all of it. Sometimes it's a government program. So the government is already running a program and you bring some innovation to it and the government says, you know what, instead of I spending the money, I'll give it to you. Or it's charity, you know, either CSR or you know, well-meaning people who want to give you money. And so there's three sources of income and you're spending money and you're creating an impact. So to make it sustainable, you do have to bring in more money than what you spend. And you have to do it in a way so that it is scalable, right? And so that's the thing. So I can give you a couple of examples. For example, I'm very involved with Akshay Patra. I started USA Akshay Patra. I've been on their board forever and so on. So what's the model there? And you all know Akshay Patra. They do 1.8 million midday meals every day. Obviously, when you serve little children cannot pay for it, right? So there is no free market aspect to Akshay Patra. So what happens there is that it costs about $40 to feed a child for the whole year. Government already has a midday meal program. So every time we go and serve in a government school, the government says, you know what, instead of I giving $20 to the school, I'll give it to you so that you can feed for the whole year. And so we get $20 from the government and we raise the other $20 from other people. And we have maybe 100,000 donors now because it's a 500 crore a year program, right? So it's made sustainable by a combination of government program and charity. Let me give you another example that we do, which we're about to scale, is a farm pond program. So what is a farm pond program? You know, there's a lot of farmers in the area where we work, Hubli, Dharwar, and so on. The rain is very unpredictable. So they may get one crop or they may not get anything. And even though there is enough rain, they don't have water when they need it. So in 2013, we started a program. In fact, Ratan Tata was the one who kick-started that program, where we dig a hole that's 100 feet by 100 feet by 12 feet. And that's enough of a space to capture rainwater and irrigate 5 acres of land. So it cost about 80,000 rupees to build a farm pond, right? And the magic of that farm pond is that it immediately doubles and triples the income of the farmer. So he makes 80,000 more within a year. So that's a fantastic payback, right? So over the last 5 years, we've done 6,000 of them, right? 6,000, 80,000 rupees a farm pond. And the model was the farmer would pay 55,000 and the charity would pay 25,000. So that would be our foundation, CSR, other donors and so on, would pay the other 25,000. So you can see it's a combination of free market and charity. Now this year, we are launching a program to do 100,000 farm ponds. So that would be like an 800 crore program, right? And so how do we model it? So out of the 80,000, the farmer pays 20,000 and we get him a loan of 60,000 and we'll continue to work with the farmer, make sure that he makes good use of the water, really actually doubles and triples the income and then pays back that loan within a year. So now you can see how if the solution lends itself to a free market, not every solution will lend itself. So Akshay Patra will not become a free market solution. But if you're working on livelihood, increasing the income and so on, if you really refine and make your programs really impactful, then you can scale them. So now we can do 100,000. If we do 100,000, then we have a model where it can scale infinitely, right? Because banks would be able to lend lots of money. People borrow the money, they build a business, they do better farming, they double, triple their income every year forever, not just 1 year, right? So I think every time you think about a model, think about how you make it sustainable. Where will the money come from? And that may be a good way to start thinking about the social entrepreneurship and the organization that you want to set up.
Great. So you are in the field more than 40 years now. So the next question is that about the ecosystem building. And I can remember that 10 years back also, we had a huge discussion about the sandbox and piloting of the social ideas and how we can then create social ventures. Now, my question is that what is the impact of this sandbox in creation of the startup ecosystem in India and in over at least 20 years, if we can consider not 40, but 20 years, how, you know, also policies are impacting in Indian scenario, this kind of ecosystem. What is your thought in this area?
Yeah. So we talked about entrepreneurship and social entrepreneurship. Another way to look at this problem is that there is 7 billion people in the world, out of which about 2 billion people have disposable income, and about 5 billion people don't have disposable income. So that's a rough cut, right? And they both have problems. And so solving their problems is what entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship is all about. When you solve the problems for the people who have disposable income, you're competing for the opportunity. Because what happens is that they have options. So every time all of you, any of you have any issue, you'll go to Google and look for solutions, right? And so you have to compete for the opportunity to make a difference in the lives of the people who have disposable income. So bringing something new to the marketplace, new to the world, becomes very important. So innovation becomes very important. And that innovation has to be directed to some burning problem that people have. So innovation plus relevance is equal to impact. So that's the secret for making impact on the people who have disposable income. Now, when you come to the other 5 billion people, particularly if you go all the way down to the bottom, those people are struggling to just get through the day. Mm-hmm. And therefore, it's not like they're looking for fantastic solutions for all the things and so on. So it's not so much innovation, but relevance becomes more important. So it's a question of co-creating the solution, because the people that you're trying to help don't live like us. They are not as privileged as any of us on this call. And therefore, it's hard to understand that customer base. So you have to co-create the solution with them. And then you have to build the capacity within those communities to be able to scale those solutions. So co-creation and building capacity becomes very important. And so this social innovation sandbox ecosystem that we have set up in Hubli Dharwar is essentially an experiment to see if we can do that. Otherwise, what happens is that the world, all the smart people want to solve solutions for the people who are not doing well, but it's all their ideas. And if you lead with an idea, you cannot have an impact, right? Because nobody buys into it. There's no capacity. You know, we can all go write good white papers and papers and, you know, write an essay and so on. But if you really want to see an impact, you have to co-create the solution and you have to build the capacity. But once you have a solution and once you have some capacity, then you have bigger and bigger ability to absorb bigger ideas, right? So for example, farm pond, first we have to create it with the farmer. You have to learn how to do it. You have to make sure that he can actually make more money. But now that we know the solution and we know what he wants to buy, we get an opportunity to inject a lot of the sophisticated things. You know, we can do financial engineering. We can make sure that, you know, 800 crore program is a large program. So you need a lot of the financial discipline. We're injecting a lot of technology. You know, there's a satellite that goes around India clicking photographs every 5 days. So given a piece of land, we can recreate the history of that land for the last 10 years. We know exactly how the water flows in that particular land. So you can ideally locate the farm pond. So to create the ecosystem for the regular entrepreneurship, you need innovation, you need new ideas, and you need to connect that to the customer. In social entrepreneurship, you need relevance. You actually cannot do it sitting in either Boston or Mumbai and solve problems of rural India. Right? You have to co-create the solution with the people who need it. You have to build capacity. And as they get more and more capacity to absorb ideas and technology and policy and money and everything else, you can inject those. What happens with policymakers is that all the think tanks, whether it's Washington or Delhi, you know, they sit in Delhi and they try to make policies, which a lot of times are not relevant, and there's no capacity to absorb these ideas. So I'm a big believer that we should do policy by proof of concept. That is, you know, places like sandboxes should try different ideas, and we know something works, then you make that into a policy. Does that make sense, Professor Guha?
Yeah. Thank you, sir. You know, then also they, my all students, you know, they attended your some YouTube lecture, and where in the videos they heard that you mentioned about aligning intent and innovation. So they all wanted to know that what do you mean by aligning intent and innovation?
Yeah, so you know, for example, I'm on the board of MIT for a long time. I work with, I'm on the advisory board of Harvard for the social entrepreneurship and so on. And so a lot of very smart people here, and I'm sure equally smart people in TESS. But what happens is, and they are very genuine in their compassion, and they really, really, really want to help people. And they can go to any foundation and say, hey, give me $20 million and poverty solved. And the foundations are actually pretty happy to give them the $20 million. And then they will innovate. They will come up with an idea that's better than any idea that already exists, right? And then they will write a book on it. They'll write a white paper. They're happy. The students will get a PhD. And then the foundation is very happy because they funded a very noble project. But then, you know, you look at all these ideas that get lined up, and then you say, how many of them are really having an impact? And you find that it's very, very few. And mostly because even though there is one machinery, one group of people who are generating all these fantastic ideas with very good intentions, there's no capacity in the community for which you're creating these ideas to absorb any of these ideas, right? So it becomes a club where everybody talks about another brilliant idea and they're happy, right? Because I mean, and they don't mean bad. They don't mean bad. They actually want to help. So I think we have to start rewarding the thinkers to make sure that they're connected with doers. So the thinkers have to come together with the doers. And of course the doers have to come together with the thinkers, because the doers tend to be social entrepreneur, not so much entrepreneur, but social workers. They have a huge amount of compassion and they give everything they have. They go spend the time with the people who need the help. But then their techniques will help maybe a few people, which is very noble, but they don't scale. So to really build these scalable social entrepreneurship interventions, we really have to get the thinkers and the doers together. Right now, the two groups of people are isolated, right? And so for example, in US, the philanthropy business is about $400 billion. You know, that's a lot of money. And then you say, how much of that goes towards idea generation versus actually connecting ideas to people? I would say the overwhelming part goes to generating ideas.
Okay, so here also we are understanding that the lot of collaboration is required from different quarters. The next question is very much contemporary issues that, you know, during the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic, from the incubation center also, I got a lot of questions from the startups and the early stage entrepreneur that to face that uncertainty and the risky situation, how should these entrepreneurs prepare themselves? And the students also raise the right questions that how they be agile enough to change their mode of operating and yet create impact in such a situation. So what is your perception? How do they take up these challenges, yet they can create impact also?
Yeah, no, I think it's a very good question. And also it says, can service learning play a role? Absolutely. I think there is three types of people in this world. Some people are oblivious. They don't even notice problems in their life, which is okay. Some people see a problem and complain. Some see a problem and get all excited about it. And so what's the difference between a vibrant community and an impoverished community is a mix of those people. In vibrant communities, what happens is that people, every time they see a problem, they get all excited about it because every problem looks like an opportunity to do something. And in fact, when you create a very vibrant community, like I see in MIT, for example, everybody wants to do something. They want to change the world. And their problem actually is not having a good enough problem to solve, right? I mean, they all like come up with these apps and phones, and they'll try to convince you that it'll save your life and all that kind of stuff, right? So in a very vibrant community, everybody is looking for a problem to solve. And it's hard to find problems. But the side effect is, in those communities, you don't have too many problems hang around too long. Because if there is a problem, somebody's going to grab it because everybody is looking at problems to solve. In impoverished communities, people, problems become chronic. They get deadlocked. They become very hard to solve. Some people try to solve them, and then they cannot do it because they're chronic and they're very, very hard. And so they feel victimized, they feel helpless, and then they start complaining. So a dominant culture of an impoverished community is one of complaining. So in some ways, social entrepreneurship is all about converting complainers into problem solvers, right? So how do you become a problem solver? You become a problem solver by actually, you know, keep your eyes open and find a problem that you fall in love with. You have to become passionate about a problem that you want to solve. When you become passionate about a problem that you want to solve, then what happens is you get so energized that you'll find a solution and you don't find any boundaries. You know, in some ways, you know, when you go through tests, that's what you do, right? I mean, your professor teaches you, they give you homework. Homework is essentially a lot of problems to solve, and you solve the problems. So solving problems is something what you do during your education. But there's a big difference. So what's the difference between that problem solving and solving a problem for entrepreneurship? When you are in school and when the professor teaches you something, so for example, let me say a Pythagoras theorem or something, some theory they've taught you, and they're giving you five problems to solve, your thinking is very constrained. You're constantly saying, how do I use Pythagoras theorem to solve this problem, right? So it's a very constrained thinking. Whereas when you fall in love with the problem, you have no constraints. So we run a program called LEAD, which is for college kids, which is more like a service program. So let's say four kids come together, they see a problem, and then they're just going to go make it happen. So for example, a project would be, you know, like four girls, they saw these little kids begging on the street. And then they said, why? Why should these kids be begging? They should be in school. So they decided to take that up on themselves. They went and met the their teachers, their parents, and everything else, and worked very closely with about 10 of them to put them back in school. They were so successful that the commissioner looked at what happened, and then he took over, and he now runs that program in the town, right? So when you fall in love with a problem, you are not constrained. You're not sort of constrained by saying, oh, I don't have money, I don't have knowledge, I don't have expertise. You want to solve that problem so badly that you'll go and get whatever you need, right? Which is actually the new way of education. You know, the old way of education is a person was taught everything, they had all the skills to do something, and then they did it for next 30 years. In the new world, you have to fall in love with a problem, and then you do whatever it takes to solve the problem. You know, because you can get all the knowledge by Googling, right? So it's more, and why is that important? That's important because the world is changing very rapidly, right? I mean, none of you are going to be doing what you think you're going to be doing 5 years from now. So you, constantly the problems are changing, the environments are changing, the tools are changing. So you don't start with a skill and say, where do I apply the skill? I mean, you can. If you just want a job, then that's what you do. But if you want to lead a change, if you want to be an entrepreneur, then you start by your love for wanting to solve a problem. And then you pull in whatever you need to solve that problem. And it's sort of, you know, you get so energized. I'm sure all of you have gone through that experience where you fall in love with a problem. You keep thinking about it, and suddenly, you know, when you're taking bath or so some movement, suddenly you think you found a solution. It may or may not be the right solution. It may be a wrong solution, but you just can't wait. You just can't wait to like just go try it out and see whether it works or not. And that kick that you get when you fall in love with a problem and your brain is like really going, looking for these solutions. Once you get a taste of that kick, you will not do anything else. You will never become a complainer, right? Complainers are the people who feel victimized, who feel helpless, who say, oh, you know, nothing can be done. There is this, there is that, you know, all kinds of stuff. So I think as students, as young people, try to get a little, you know, more and more taste of that excitement. When you fall in love with something and you want to solve it at any cost, and you come up with these solutions, which a lot of them fail. You know, you probably know the story of Thomas Edison when he came up with a bulb. When he came up with a bulb, I think he had called the press conference 99 times, thinking that he had a solution. And every time the press conference, you know, everything would be ready, he would want to demonstrate it, and the thing would not work, right? So when he failed the 99th time, the press finally got tired of this whole thing, and they said, well, you know, aren't you totally disappointed 99 times? I mean, how many times can you keep trying this? He said, no, I know at least 99 times it doesn't work. So now I can look for the solution that really works, right? And he did. And so I think experiencing that kick that you get when you come up with a solution and you just can't wait to try it out is what entrepreneurship is about.
Thank you, sir. Just one question, and then we will go to the audience. Some of the questions they posted in the Q&A. The question on behalf of my students, I'm asking that, you know, few of them are very clear that they are graduating and then they start their venture. But sometimes they are confused that whether 2-3 years they should work in the industry or they should just start their social enterprise, you know, upfront. So you have such a vast knowledge of entrepreneurship for 40-50 years. So can you, sir, throw some light so that my young students get some idea that what they can think and decide about what is the right time to take up the entrepreneurship.
Sure, sure. So, you know, in some ways, there is never a bad time or the right time to start your entrepreneurship journey, right? That is, let's say you graduate and then you have a job with another organization, a well-paying job, and you have an entrepreneurship opportunity. So constantly you're doing the two columns and trying to compare the pros and cons and which way I should go, all that kind of stuff. If you're doing all that, then you should take up the job. You're not quite ready for it. The time you should start something on your own is when you are in love with that particular idea so badly that you just can't help yourself. You have to do it, right? So it doesn't mean that's the right idea. You know, so there is two things, conviction and perseverance, right? Your conviction has to be so strong that is just a fantastic idea and you just have to do it. You don't have a choice. That's when you start an organization, whether for profit or nonprofit. You should, if you force yourself to become an entrepreneur, it just won't work, because if as soon as you start, whatever it is, you'll only find three things. You'll find that it's a lot harder than what you thought. You'll find that it'll take a lot more money than you thought. And you'll find that it's going to take a lot longer. So there's only bad news, right? There's no good news after you start. And if you don't have that strong perseverance and conviction that it's worth doing it, you'll give up at the very first hurdle that you get. And which just means that you're not ready for it, right? So I think it'll come very naturally to you. And some people are ready for it very early. For example, you know, you'll always see examples of Bill Gates and Mark Zuckerberg and all these guys. They didn't even wait to complete their education, right? I mean, they had such strong conviction that they actually dropped out of school and did it. There are people who graduate and then start companies. There are people who start companies when they're, you know, when they go work and they, you know, get a lot more experience on how to do it, and then they start a company. There are people who start companies and organizations when they're in their 50s or 70s or 80s, right? So you can start the organization anytime, but it should not be a forced thing, because it just won't survive. You know, within 3 months, 6 months, you'll give up, and then it'll be a very bitter experience. So if anybody comes to me and says, should I start a new organization, whether social entrepreneurship or entrepreneurship, as soon as they ask me, you all probably all know what the answer is. The answer is no. Because when you want to do it, you want to do it so badly that you're not going to wait for somebody else's approval. In fact, whenever you want to start something new, all the people who look after you, who care for you, they will all actually discourage you. Not because they don't love you or they don't want you to be successful, but because they can just see why it's a harder path and how you may be able to get hurt, right? And so you're actually starting something in spite of a lot of the people saying, don't do it. But you're thinking through it, right? I mean, every time people bring up an objection, you want to think through it and say, in spite of those 250 objections, I still want to do it because I have answers to at least those 250. There may be 251 that I don't have an answer to, but I'm going to figure it out. And the reason why that conviction is very important is because the first time you come across a hurdle, everybody who loves you is going to come and say, I told you so. I told you not to do this, all right? And so in some ways, it's a discouraging thing. And for you to go through that experience and still stick with it and still make it happen, you have to be convinced. And every company, every organization, everything that you see set up in the world, you know, including TIS, there was somebody who wanted to set it up. And I'm sure he or she went through the same path. I mean, it wasn't an easy thing. And so, but at the same time, the reason why all of you, first, you should become entrepreneurial, right? In the way you think. So even if you work for a smaller organizations, and there may be an entrepreneur who started an organization, work with them and be entrepreneurial. You know, don't get hung up and stuck up in too much of bureaucracy and policy making and everything else. Become entrepreneurial. And once you have enough experience, maybe you can become an entrepreneur. Why is that important as a career? Because you know how much the world has changed. And all of you are young people, but within the last 5-10 years, you can see how much it has changed. And it's going to change even more, and it's going to change even faster. So whenever the world changes, each one of us have two options. Either we grudgingly accept the change, or we lead the change, right? And if you want to lead the change so that it becomes a better world, that's the opportunity to be a social entrepreneur or a regular entrepreneur. So I think there's going to be plenty of opportunities for people who want to be entrepreneurs or entrepreneurial. And so I think, but you really have to get the right mindset to be able to play that game.
Okay. Sir, there are several questions for you. So first question from Abhikaran, where he's asking, what steps will encourage youth to take up entrepreneurship as a career choice in India? And what skills you think are needed to be developed early among learners? Can service learning play a role in developing these skills?
Yeah, you know, it's happening quite a bit in India now. You know, entrepreneurship is mainstream. The main thing you have to teach people is that it's perfectly fine to fail, right? I mean, unless you are able to deal with failure, you'll never become an entrepreneur, because you can never try anything new if you're afraid of failing. So giving people confidence and getting them to try new things and being excited about their ideas. And if they don't work, then it's called the pivoting, right? I mean, you come up with a solution that's something different and you try that one. And so that sense of experimentation and sense of trying and wanting to do things, if you develop that that mindset, then, you know, they become problem solvers for life.
Okay. Sir, next question from Shiv Shankar. He wrote that given the CSR rules becoming much clearer in India with several amendments, isn't it a right time for the government to also create clear legislation for the social enterprises?
Well, you know, you shouldn't worry about all that. It's two different messages. One is people who want to be entrepreneurs and people who are in the business of setting policies and ecosystems and so on. Each one of you, you know, in the next, whatever, 5-10 years, you're going to be a little bit more on the entrepreneurial path. If you're an entrepreneur, you're going to make that thing work against all odds. You're going to bulldoze through any problem. So if you're an ecosystem player, your job is to reduce the friction for the success of those entrepreneurs, right? For example, I was an entrepreneur for a long time, but now I'm a little bit more into building the ecosystem for other entrepreneurs to be successful. So I think there's a lot of stuff that, you know, you can get more access to capital, you can get better access to what they do and so on. So there are several things policymakers can do to reduce the friction, but you shouldn't worry about it. I mean, if you want to be an entrepreneur, you know, companies got started, whether it's Infosys or Wipro, whatever, 30, 40, 50 years ago, and there was no ecosystem, right? They were all pioneers. So there's every field has pioneers, but those people have such strong conviction that they're going to make it happen with or without any help from anybody else, right? So if you're an entrepreneur, I would say bulldoze through your ideas, bulldoze through the problems and just make it happen. If you're a ecosystem setter, if you're a policymaker or a philanthropist or something who is trying to reduce friction for these people, then I think it's a different issue.
Sir, next question from Charles. He wrote, "Sir, can you please tell us about the different aspects and characteristics of scalable model and how to build one?"
Well, scalable models are, you know, I think if the solution can lend itself to free market, that's probably the easiest one, because then you can scale them infinitely. You know, just because it like the revenue that comes in is enough to pay for the cost of that intervention that you're coming up with. If that's, you know, bringing innovation to a government program, that's also infinitely scalable, because government is the biggest spender of interventions. If you do charity as a part of scaling things, make sure that your money doesn't come from one or two funders. It has to come from thousands of funding agencies, because only when people give you 5 rupees, 10 rupees, 100 rupees, 1,000 rupees, and there's a lots of them, then you have a sustainable model. So I think looking at financially sustainable models is very important if you want to scale them.
Okay, sir. Next question from Mr. Tripathi. What's your take on current status of social entrepreneurship, where traditional business ideas are made aligned with SDGs? Will this help in real growth?
Oh, absolutely. Development growth. I think what happens is that in fact that's the main thrust that our foundation works on. You know, we talked about regular entrepreneurship and regular businesses where actually execution excellence is very good, right? I mean, when you run a business, let's say you run a hotel and you serve masala dosa, you serve bad masala dosa for 2-3 days, that's the end of your business, right? You're out of business. So execution excellence is very good in business. But sometimes businesses lose their compassion and they start doing silly things which will hurt the environment, which will hurt people, which will hurt the society and so on. Now, on the social entrepreneurship side, compassion is given, because without compassion, you don't start any of those organizations. However, execution excellence is missing. You know, you don't really have sort of scalable organizations and so on. So I think we need to bring execution excellence to the nonprofit world, to the social sector, and compassion to the for-profit sector. So all the for-profit sectors now, companies, they always are repurposing themselves. And they're saying, it's not enough to have a revenue and just profits. We have to have a purpose, people, and profits. We have to have all the three. Otherwise, all the young people like you who are graduating these days, they don't want to work for companies where the purpose isn't obvious, where they don't care for people. So if you want to build a good company these days, you have to make sure that you're doing all of that stuff, all the activities that you do in the company for a very specific purpose, which has a clear mission that can inspire people and say, you know what, it's worth me getting up in the morning and going to work, because if I work hard here, I'm going to make a difference in somebody's life. So purpose is very important. Caring for people is very important. And profits are also important, because if you don't have profits, you can't scale that business.
Okay. So the question Rajesh asked that, can you please elaborate on support provided by Deshpande Foundations for the startups?
So we have an incubator. It's a 100,000 square foot incubator. And if you have an idea, you can apply. And if you do get, you know, we have lots of programs. We have programs for the people who are just thinking about it. We have programs for the people who already have an idea but don't have a company yet. And we have programs for the people who have a company, who have some revenue, but it hasn't scaled yet. So depending on what stage you're in, you can apply. And there's lots of other incubators also in India. So but the incubator in Hubli, the Deshpande Foundation, that is targeted squarely at entrepreneurs who are trying to come up with solutions for the semi-urban and rural India.
Okay. The last question from Mukul. Do you think that social entrepreneurship needs are different in emerging and developed nations?
Well, you know, social entrepreneurship is probably will mature faster in developing countries, you know, because India is a very exciting place for social entrepreneurship for two reasons. Number one, the problems are huge, right? And they're everywhere. So I talked about people who have disposable income, non-disposable income. In India, it's probably 20%, 80%. In US, it'll be 80%, 20%, right? So in India, it's very difficult for you to live without actually noticing a lot of these people right around you, all the problems right around you. At the same time, India also has a lot of talent now. You know, unlike when I left India in 1973, a long time ago. And in 73, even though I graduated from IIT Madras in computers, I'd never seen a computer in my life, right? So there was a huge difference between anything that existed in the rest of the world and India. There was not a lot of confidence. There were not a lot of resources. There weren't too many things that were built in India that were global in nature. Now, fast forward today, I would say 1 to 2% of the population in India, including all of you people, that is what, 14 to 30 million people, are second to none globally in terms of their abilities, whether it's professors or engineers or doctors or accountants or anything you think about. So there's a globally very competent talent in India, and you have all these big problems right around there, right around you. So applying those talents to solving these social problems will probably likely happen a lot more in India before it happens in other places. So I think I'm hoping that India will become the beacon of hope for the rest of the world and show the rest of the world as to how social entrepreneurship should be done. And I think all of you have an exciting leadership role to play in that journey. And so I wish all of you a fantastic entrepreneurial career. Don't worry if you're not successful in the first one or second one or third one, you will be successful. You just have to enjoy the opportunity to be that entrepreneur, because that kick is just amazing. You know, I think when you fall in love with something, you just can't wait to get up in the morning and do what it is that you're thinking about, right? And if you can live every day of your life being excited about what you're going to be doing that day, you have it made. And there's nothing more to life than that. And I think all of you have an opportunity to do that. So I want to wish you all the best. And I know we're running out of time now, so.
Thank you, sir. And such a positive note. And I think all my students have a lot of opportunity to do fantastic work. And thank you for coming and enlightening us about a whole sphere of social entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship in the world and in India. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Well, we have a lot of questions and increasing participation from the attendees, but due to time constraint, we won't be able to take them all. Once again, thank you so much, Gururaj sir, for this wonderful, inspiring session, and also Samapti ma'am for moderating it. We have Sir Philip Kotler in the room, so without taking much time, let's